So our first song will be Lift Up the Trumpet, Loud Let It Ring. Jesus is coming again. And this is not a song that you can really sing while you're sitting down. So I'd like to invite you all to stand and we will sing Lift Up the Trumpet.
Joyful and sing, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus is coming again. Echo with hilltops proclaim it to plains, Jesus is coming again. Coming in glory, the Lamb slain, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus is coming again.
Ravings of a town, the vast wandering throng, Jesus is coming again. Tempest and roaming, the
next song is called Follow the Lamb, and it's been one of our theme songs from past ASI. As we've been learning about the end times, we read in Revelation 14:4 that we are to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. And where has the Lamb gone? The Lamb is in heaven, heavenly sanctuary, interceding on our behalf. And the Bible says, Thy way, O Lord, is in the sanctuary. And so we're going to sing Follow the Lamb, and we can think of those heavenly imagery when we sing it.
Longing for the day when we arrive.
Our last song that we will sing before we hear the message is Rapid, our theme song.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, how many of you are thankful to be here? Amen. A lot of you. And how many are thankful for all the people who are working behind the scenes to make this convention happen. You know, we are very grateful for the technicians who are streaming so other people can see, and we can see the recordings afterwards and share it with our friends. We're thankful for the kitchen crew, for all the volunteers, for those who are cleaning and making trips to pick up people. There's all sorts of people working in the background. And I'd like to encourage all of us to just take one moment, like when you see someone, you know they're working, maybe they're cleaning or they're doing something that maybe seems very humble, but take a moment to thank them and say, I really appreciate what you're doing. Will you all do that? Amen? Amen? Yes, because it's great to be thankful in our hearts, but with the mouth, profession is made of our faith, right? We don't just enjoy it in our hearts, but we can encourage someone along the way. So as we begin this time together, or we'll continue this time together, I'd like to ask you to stand with me, and we're going to have a prayer, and then we're going to invite Pastor Klaus Lundstrom to come and share with us a greeting from the East Norwegian Conference. But let us stand and have a prayer first. Our Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for all your blessings, for the blessings of being here, for the life that you give us, for the fellowship that we have enjoyed, for the inspiring messages from your word. We thank you for all the people, the household of faith that you have brought together in this place. We are thankful that it is the Sabbath, the gift that you have given us to enjoy fellowship with you, our Creator. And we just pray that your Spirit may be with us here as it was on the day of creation. And maybe some of us have some burdens that we need to let go of. And we just pray that you take those away, and may this Sabbath be a blessing to all of us here. And so we just want to thank you again and ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. May be seated, please. You want to? Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Well, first of all, let me say that I'm very happy that you have chosen Tyrifjord Church, one of the churches in the East Norwegian Conference, to host this conference. You have been here many times before, I know that, but I'm very happy that you're here again. I was asked by Joachim to just give some greetings to you, and I called the union president. You know, it's always best to have his blessings for what you say. So I called him and asked Victor Marley, what do you want me to say? So these are his words, but I also agree with him. We appreciate very much everyone who gets involved in mission and evangelistic endeavors. We appreciate the trust that has grown between supporting ministries, ASI, and the Norwegian Union Conference, and the three local conferences that we have here, and the development that has taken place the last years. Because good communication, constructive leadership, and openness from all contributes to that we can complement each other, support each other, lift up each other when it comes to sharing His word. And we can all work together for unity according to the prayer that Jesus prayed in John 17. So thank you for your commitment and for your faithful service to the Lord. But I also want to share some greetings of spiritual character, maybe a little bit more than that that was just mentioned. Now we are getting closer to the new year. Tomorrow, New Year's Eve, 2022 becomes 2023. And we start to look in different directions. We can look back, remember the year that has passed, and for some of us, there has been good memories, maybe some bad memories. But we can also look forward and look at what will happen next year. What are my plans? What sort of is there for me? What can I expect? And we look into the future and we say, oh, yeah, oh, okay. We can also look out in the world around us, and we see a world that is crumbling down to, well, who knows what, economically, politically, on all spheres, we can see that something is happening, and we can concentrate on that if we want to. But we can also look inward to ourselves and our own spiritual development. How is it with Galatians 2:20? I live, but does Christ live in me? And finally, a thought that I would like to leave with you then is not only look back, forward, out and in, which might be important in itself, but look up. When Abraham was sacrificing Isaac, he looked up, and God had the solution for him, which was looking forward to Jesus Christ hanging on the cross. Look up on the cross. Two women were on their way to the grave, Jesus' grave. They didn't know how to move the stone. And the scripture tells us that when they looked up, they saw that the stone was gone. Christ had risen. Focus on the risen Christ. Look up. Look up on the cross and on the living Christ, because that's what will take us securely into the end times. We can concentrate on the past and the future outside. Wow, big things are happening. But if we lose our focus upwards towards the cross and to the risen Christ, the other things, well. So that's what we want to leave with you, and hope that this conference will bring that to you. And that will be a main thought for the new year that is fastly approaching in some hours. So hope you have a good, wonderful Sabbath together, and that Sabbath will take you into a new, wonderful, happy new 2023. God bless you.
Thank you so much for your words of encouragement. And now I'm going to invite Simon to come up and talk about Steps for Life.
Yes, how many have heard about Steps for Life? Can I see hands on you? I was many. How many have been on a Steps for Life week? Quite many as well. This is really practical, like Klaus was talking about. We see a world that is falling apart, and Steps for Life is a ministry who tries to help at least a few in this world that is falling apart in many ways. So what is Steps for Life? For you who haven't heard about Steps for Life is a voluntary-based group that started a health initiative like 10 years ago, almost now. And I was part of that core group in the beginning and still am. And we do like a health center, but it's portable. So we rent a place, and during a 7-day program, we do a health week together. And I'm going to show some pictures quickly here. So the program is a holistic way of helping people with their physical, spiritual, mental, and social health. And it's very much a foundation of trying to teach people lifestyle habits and lifestyle keys to improve their lifestyle and improve their health more or less. And we do that through different activities. So you could say it's like a traveling Fredheim or like a traveling health center in different places. So we do, as you can see here, we do the different blood tests in the beginning. We have a holistic plant-based food and exercise, of course. And we do different lectures on health, cooking demonstration, we have music. We do the different coaching and counseling as well when it comes to their health problems. We started in 2012 and have since then done 1 or 2 or sometimes 3 weeks every year. And we have seen this concept also spread to both to Norway here, to Denmark, to different countries in Europe as well who have taken the same concept and done it in their own countries. And it's been a really blessing to be part of this practical way of helping people. So this was our original group in 2013, 9 years ago, in Sweden. And this was 2014, we did 1 week as well. And here we was. Does anyone know where this is? Yeah, that's correct. It's on the coast down Göteborg, a little bit down, and Steningsund, so close to Halmstad. Very beautiful place. Does anyone know where this is? It's close to Slussfors. Do you think it's the south or the north of Sweden? Yeah, it's the north. You see the mountains. So this is close to my home area, actually. It's about 14 hours by car north in Sweden. And so the northern people also reached with the health message. Very beautiful place, 2015. And it even says it here. You see this place? We did a Steps for Life Health Week at Fredheim, who do similar weeks all year around. But here we did it together with Madison Mission School. I think that was the first year we did it, 2015, together, and I think it's still a cooperation between Steps for Life, Fredheim, and Madison. Yeah, Jeremy says thumb up, so they do it once a year together with Fredheim and Steps for Life. And during Corona, we didn't do any weeks for 2 or 3 years, and actually this year we did a unique new week. Do you see the place here? Where is it? Yes, Hagegården, so at Lifestyle TV's place in Värmland, Sweden. So we did a cooperation, Steps for Life, together with Lifestyle TV. Did a really blessed week, and the guests were fantastic and very satisfied with the week. Here you can see both the staff and the guests. And here are all the guests who this summer was part of the Health Week. Very beautiful place. And here you can see the guests. Some Norwegians as well, so it's a mix of Swedish and Norwegian guests. I think we were 18 guests. And I'm just going to show some pictures of the activities that we did during the week. Some walking, of course, and a lot of conversation and so on. And massage, of course, and some delicious plant-based food. And here we had some social fellowship as well. And Teresa showed some healthy plant-based meals. So it's a lot of focus on teaching people how to not just live healthy during a health week, but to live healthy during the rest of their life, of course. And we finished off in the middle of the week to a boat trip as well in Värmland there. So it was a really blessed week, hikes and all of it. And of course, we did some nice decoration of a banquet in the end as well, where the guests share their testimonies, what they experienced throughout the week. And what's new for this, the last few years, we have developed also a manual that if anyone else, we have it in Swedish and English. So if anyone want to copy or take inspiration from the Steps for Life concept, you can just talk to me. And we have actually created a manual of like step to step how to do it. If your local church or your team want to try something similar. So you spread that word. That's something we want to spread. Challenges is always when it's voluntary work that it's, yeah, most people, they have a work that they work with, so it's hard to get people to take time for it. And it's also sometimes hard to get good cooperation with a local church. Of course, we want to do it together with a mission-minded local church. But I wanted to finish to share a little shortly just with Marta, that was one of the guests who has come many years. She came this year too. You see her in the picture. She came on the first week 9 years ago, and she was also here now, as you can see. And she came 9 years ago with very bad arthritis in her hands. She had to quit her job. She couldn't fold a paper. She couldn't touch like this because her arthritis was so bad in her hand. She couldn't like give out a card of deck because her arthritis was so bad. And she had depression and other health issues as well. After 1 week, when she came home, she had stopped all her pain medication. She transformed her diet completely. Her husband was a pig farmer, but he was a retired pig farmer, so they didn't do it anymore. But he also changed his lifestyle. And 3 months later, when we had a follow-up weekend, he said he was sick in the hospital, and he said, "Go for the follow-up weekend. I've seen how this has changed your life. I now have a new wife, so I want you to leave me here at the hospital and go to the follow-up weekend because I've seen the impact it has made on you." They are not Adventists. They have brought maybe 10 people throughout the years to come to our Steps for Life weeks. They are probably the best marketers for Steps for Life we have ever had. And they share this year as well the blessings that they experience, and they always talk very good for the Adventist people, because of the health impacts they have experienced throughout their weeks. And now she can fold papers, and her hands has actually gotten much better, and she doesn't have any medication anymore. And yeah, she has a completely new life after a Steps for Life week. So that's just one example of what people can experience. And the vision is that we want to spread this to other more countries, and that more people and more churches take the health message and use it in a practical way. And I just want to say go forward. And if anyone want to join a week, then we talk to me or let us know, and we will organize a week in the future as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Simon. So it's going to be soon time for the message. And I would just... Yeah, you all know Emanuel Baek. He was introduced a few nights ago. I have a question for you, though. How many of you were not alive 25 years ago? Okay. That's a few hands. Yeah, interesting. So 25 years ago was the last time we met. And it's amazing how, like... You don't meet someone for so long, and then you pick up where you left off. It's just kind of like, I think in heaven we'll see someone. Oh, I haven't seen you for so many years, and then you just pick it up. And it's been wonderful to have him here and just reconnect a bit. And also, I just wanted to share with you personally when we were in college together. And I think it's the same. He really likes to dig deep into the word, you know, not just like a shallow scratching on the surface. He wants to dive in deep. And so I've really appreciated the messages here, and also, just being able to fellowship. So before Emanuel comes up to share the message tonight, called Links in the Chain. And we have Sylvia Pell translating into Norwegian, which we are thankful for. Jenny Levison will bring us a message in song called How Beautiful. And then you will hear Emanuel.
In the stillness of my heart, I will wait for you. In the close of I will speak your name. With my voice I will saving grace that you would call me as
Good evening, everyone.
God kveld, alle sammen.
I want to tell you what a privilege it has been to be here with you here in this beautiful setting in Norway.
Jeg vil bare uttrykke hvilket privilegium det har vært for meg å være I den fantastiske vakre settingen her I Norge.
Tonight, the title of my message is called "Links in the Chain."
Og I kveld så tema for talen min leddene I denne kjeden.
And I want to say this very plainly to you tonight.
Jeg ønsker å si dette ganske tydelig.
I believe that in the end, if we are lost,
jeg tror at hvis vi går fortapt når det kommer til slutten,
it will be because of the chains of our own forging.
Så kommer det til å være på grunn av de lenkene som vi selv har formet.
Let me say one more time.
La meg si det en gang til.
If we are lost,
hvis vi går fortapt,
it will be because of the chains of our own forging.
Så kommer det til å være på grunn av de lenkene vi selv har formet.
Tonight we continue in our study of Luke chapter 17.
I kveld fortsetter vi studiet vårt I Lukas kapittel 17.
Tonight I want to talk to you about the story of Lot.
Og jeg har lyst til å snakke med dere om historien om Lot.
In verse 28, the Bible tells us, likewise also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all.
Fra vers 28 så står det, på samme måten var det I Lots dager. De spiste, de drakk, de kjøpte, de solgte, de plantet, de bygde. Men den dagen da Lot gikk ut av Sodoma, regnet det ild og svovel fra himmelen og ødela dem alle.
The destruction that came to Sodom and Gomorrah was very rapid.
Den ødeleggelsen som kom over Sodoma og Gomorra, det var en ødeleggelse som skjedde veldig raskt.
The destruction of Lot's daughters and his sons-in-laws was also very rapid.
Og det gjaldt også ødeleggelsen av hans døtre og hans svigersønner.
Lot's wife becoming a pillar of salt was also rapid.
Og det at hans kone ble til en saltstøtte, det var også noe som skjedde veldig raskt.
But the circumstances which led to those events were a long time in the making.
Men de omstendighetene som ledde til disse begivenhetene, det var noe som hadde dratt ut over lengre tid.
We are told that the marriage of Lot,
vi blir fortalt at Lot sitt ekteskap,
and his choice for Sodom as a home,
og det at han valgte Sodoma som sitt hjem,
were the first links in a chain of events.
Det var de første lenkene, de første leddene I en lenke av begivenheter,
that were fraught with evil,
som hadde blitt skapt gjennom ondskap.
When I read this, I thought to myself, the marriage of Lot?
Og når jeg leste dette, så tenkte jeg, Lot sitt ekteskap?
What does the Bible have to say about this?
Hva har Bibelen å si om dette?
I hope you are awake.
Jeg håper dere våkne.
I want to do a Bible study with you.
For jeg vil at vi skal ha et bibelstudie sammen.
And I hope you look at this with me because it's important that you see it for yourself.
Og det viktig at dere ser dette selv ifra Bibelen.
Would you come back with me to the book of Genesis?
Bli med meg til første Mosebok.
Come with me to chapter 11.
Og slå opp der til det 11. kapitlet.
I want to ask you to look with me at Genesis chapter 11, starting from verse 27.
Og jeg vil at vi skal se på første Mosebok, kapittel 11, og fra vers 27.
And in Genesis 11, verse 27, we are going to be introduced to Lot.
Og der blir vi introdusert til Lot.
The Bible says, now these, verse 27 says, now these are the generations of Terah. Terah begat Abram and Nahor and Haran begat Lot.
Og I vers 27 så står det, dette Taras slektsbok. Tara ble far til Abram, Nahor og Haran. Haran ble far til Lot.
in verse 29, the Bible tells us that Abram and Nahor took them wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarah, the name of Nahor's wife Milcah, and the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah and the father of Iscah.
Og I vers 29 så står det, så tok Abram og Nahor seg koner. Navnet på Abrams kone var Sarai, og navnet på Nahors kone var Milka, datter av Haran. Haran var far til Milka og far til Iscah.
Verse 30 goes to the detail of telling us that Abraham's wife could not have children.
Og I vers 30 så får vi vite denne detaljen om at Abrams kone var ufruktbar.
Now, verse 31 is the verse that in my mind makes our point the clearest.
Men I vers 31 så synes jeg at vi får det mest tydelige poenget frem.
And Terah took Abram's wife, I'm sorry, and Terah took Abram his son and Lot the son of Haran his son's son and Sarah his daughter-in-law and his son Abram's wife and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan and they came unto Haran and dwelt there.
Terah tok sin sønn Abram og sin sønnesønn Lot, Harans sønn og sin svigerdatter Sarai, sin sønn Abrams kone, og så dro de ut fra Ur I Kaldea for å reise til Kanans land. De kom til Haran og bosatte seg der.
I want to ask you, in this passage that we just read,
I dette avsnittet vi nettopp leste,
was there a mention of any weddings?
Ble det nevnt noen bryllup der?
Yeah. Look at verse 29.
Se på vers 29.
It says that Abraham married Sarah.
Det står at Abraham gifte seg med Sara.
And Nahor had a wife named Milcah.
Og Nahor hadde en kone som het Milka.
Now I know what some of you are thinking. You're thinking, oh, but this is Abraham. He's so important that the Bible has to mention him.
Og dere tenker sikkert at ja, men Abraham, han en sånn viktig person, så Bibelen må jo nevne han.
Most of you probably have not heard anything about Nahor before.
Men kanskje mange ikke har hørt om Nahor tidligere.
And yet it mentions that he had a wife.
Og likevel så nevnes det at Nahor hadde en kone.
But did you notice that there's something missing here?
Men la dere merke til at det noe som mangler?
Do you know what's missing?
Hva det som mangler?
There's no mention of Lot having a wife.
Det står ikke at Lot hadde en kone.
This may come as a surprise to you.
Og kanskje kommer det som en overraskelse.
But I believe that Lot left Ur without being married.
Men jeg tror at Lot forlot Ur uten å være gift.
Come with me to Genesis 12.
Bli med meg til 1. Mosebok kapittel 12.
Look at verse 4.
Og se på vers 4.
So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran.
Så dro Abram av sted, slik Herren hadde sagt til ham, og Lot gikk med ham. Abram var 75 år gammel da han dro ut fra Haran.
But in verse 5 the Bible says, and Abraham took Sarah his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came.
Og så fra vers 5 så står det, så tok Abram sin kone Sarai og sin brorsønn Lot, og alle eiendelen de hadde samlet seg, og folket de som de hadde knyttet til seg Haran, så dro de av sted for å reise til Kanans land, og de kom til Kanans land.
Did you notice anything again?
La dere merke til noe?
It mentions Abraham, it mentions his wife, it even mentions that they took Lot and all of their things, but there's strangely no mention of Lot having a wife.
Det står at Abraham reiste ut, og Sarai reiste ut, og det står til og med at de tok med seg alle sine eiendeler, og Lot var med, men det ikke noe som nevnes om Lots kone.
Come with me to Genesis 13.
Slå opp meg til det 13. Kapitlet I 1. Mosebok.
Verse 1, the Bible says, and Abraham went up out of Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him, into the south.
Vers 1, Abraham dro opp fra Egypt, han og hans kone og alt det han eide. Lot var med ham på reisen mot Negev.
I just want to point out, again, there's no mention of Lot's wife.
Og igjen, så ser vi at Lots kone ikke nevnes.
Now come to chapter 14.
Men så kommer vi til kapittel 14.
Look at verse 12.
Og la oss se sammen på vers 12.
The Bible says that when these kings of this Canaan territory came, it says in verse 12 that they took Lot, Abraham's brother's son, who dwelt in Sodom, and his goods, and departed.
Og det står at når disse kongene kom og erobret, så tok de med seg Lot, Abrahams brorsønn, som bodde I Sodoma, sammen med det han eide, og dro av sted.
I want to ask you, where does Lot live now?
Hvor var det Lot bodde her I det avsnittet vi leser om?
He lives in Sodom.
I Sodoma.
And these Canaanite kings came, they captured him. It's strangely, it mentions Lot and his things, but there's no mention of his family. No daughters, no wife, nothing.
Og fienden kom og erobret Sodoma og tok med seg da Lot, ikke sant? Og hans eiendeler nevnes, men merkelig nok, ikke hans kone, ikke hans barn.
And verse 16 tells us,
og I vers 16 så står det,
that he brought, when Abraham rescued him, he brought back all the goods and also brought back his brother Lot and his goods and the woman also and the people.
Så kom han tilbake med alt som var av verdi, og han hadde også med seg sin brorsønn Lot og alt han eide sammen med kvinnene og resten av folket.
Now, I think that this is significant.
Og jeg tror dette betydningsfullt.
Because between Genesis 14 and Genesis 19.
For mellom første Mosebok 14 og første Mosebok 19.
Lot gets married.
Så det at Lot blir gift.
And then he has daughters.
Og så han døtre.
And we are told that this marriage of Lot was the first link in the chain of events that would lead to great evil.
Og så blir vi fortalt at dette ekteskapet som Lot hadde, det var den første lenken, ledde I denne lenken som ledde til at han falt.
I believe that Lot married a woman who was from Sodom or was a Canaanite.
Jeg tror at Lot gifte seg med en kvinne fra Sodoma som var en kananer.
Now, I know that there are some in here because after my first sermon, I had a lot of conversations with people. But I know that some of you in here will recognize that when you study the Bible, you should try to see if you're on the right track by looking at the spirit of prophecy.
Og etter den første talen som jeg hadde her, så fikk jeg mange mennesker som kom til meg med tilbakemeldinger, og vi hadde samtaler. Jeg tror det viktig når vi studerer Bibelen, at vi også sammenligner det med profetien sånn.
And so we read in Patriarchs and Prophets,
og vi leser I Patriarker og Profeter,
the wife of Lot,
at Lots kone,
was a selfish and irreligious woman.
Var en selvisk og ikke-religiøs kvinne.
Now, that doesn't prove anything.
Og det beviser jo ingenting.
It does not prove that she was a Canaanite or a Sodomite.
Det beviser ikke at hun var en kananer eller at hun var fra Sodoma.
But what it does tell us is that Lot's first mistake that led to this great evil was the choice of the woman that he married.
Men det det forteller oss at det valget som Lot tok når han gifte seg med denne kvinnen, det var et feilsteg. Som ledet til dette store fallet.
I'm going to confess something to you.
Jeg vil bekjenne noe til dere.
This is not my first ASI.
Det her ikke den første ASI som jeg har vært på.
I've actually been to a few of these.
Jeg har vært til noen flere.
And I don't know if you understand this, but in the United States, when you go to ASI,
og jeg vet ikke om dere forstår dette, men I USA, når du reiser til ASI,
it's largely it's a lot of old rich people.
Så det for det meste mange gamle rike mennesker.
But this ASI Scandinavia?
Men ASI Scandinavia
is very different.
Är väldigt annorlunda.
Because I mean as I started looking around I thought to myself like this almost seems like a youth conference like a GYC kind of a thing.
For meg, når jeg ser på dere, så tenker jeg at dette her ser ut som en slags ungdomstreff, sånn type GYC eller noe sånt.
And I'm not that smart, but I'm also not that dumb.
Og jeg ikke så veldig smart, men jeg heller ikke veldig dum.
When I sit in the cafeteria at mealtimes,
når jeg sitter I kafeterien under måltidene,
I feel the electricity in the air.
Så kjenner jeg liksom på elektrisiteten I lufta.
There is so much chemistry going on that it's unbelievable.
Det så mye kjemi som foregår, det helt utrolig.
I think there's like I think I smell Axe body spray and pheromones going around.
Jeg tror jeg lukter feromoner som florerer.
And I want you to know something.
Og jeg vil at dere skal vite noe.
In this room right now.
I dette rommet her og nå.
It is very possible.
Så det veldig mulig.
That the next Joachim Hjortland is in here.
At neste Joachim Hjortland her inne.
The next Daniel Pell could be in this room.
Neste Daniel Pell kunne være her I rommet.
The next Klaus Nybo could be in this room.
Neste Klaus Nybo kunne vært her I rommet.
The next Daniel Pedley could be in this room.
Den neste Daniel Pedley kunne være her I rommet.
The next Melvin Sandlin could be in this room.
Neste Melvin Sandelin kunne være her I rommet.
Do you understand what I'm saying? The next generation of leaders in God's church is in this room.
Det kan godt tenkes at neste generasjon av ledere her I dette rommet.
You think Satan is just waiting around?
Tror dere at Satan bare venter?
Oh, it looks like he got married.
Ja, ser ut som den ble gift.
Let's go work on him now.
La oss jobbe med ham.
Satan is already laying plans to destroy you right now.
Her og nå så legger Satan planer for å ødelegge deg.
Satan knows that one of the most successful strategies to thwart your zeal and your energy and your talents is to put you with someone that is wrong for you.
Satan vet at den mest effektive måten å ødelegge deg på å føre deg sammen med en som vil lede deg bort fra Kristus.
I want you to know that if we are lost, it will be because of the chains of our own forging.
Jeg vil gjenta at hvis vi går fortapt, så det på grunn av disse lenkene som vi selv har skapt.
I'm going to tell you a true story from my church.
Og jeg skal fortelle dere en sann historie fra menigheten min.
I have a little church.
Jeg har en liten menighet.
And inside of that church is a lovely church member.
Og der I denne menigheten så det et elskverdig menighetsmedlem.
And she is single.
Og hun enslig. Hun single.
And one day she brought someone to church.
Og en dag så tok hun med seg noen til menigheten.
And later on she told me that this was her boyfriend.
Og så fortalte hun meg senere at dette var kjæresten hennes.
Her mother passed away.
Så var det at moren hennes gikk bort, døde.
And after her mother passed away, she told me that her boyfriend asked her to marry her.
Og etter at moren døde, så fortalte hun meg at kjæresten hadde spurt om de skulle gifte seg.
Now, I want you to know that I'm divorced.
Og jeg vil at dere skal vite at jeg skilt.
So I avoid giving people advice about who to marry.
Så jeg veldig forsiktig med å gi råd om hvem man skal gifte seg med.
But I can easily give advice about who not to marry.
Men jeg kan veldig enkelt gi råd om hvem man ikke skulle gifte seg med.
Because I want you to know that when she told me, well, you know, I said the first question was, is he an Adventist?
Og det første spørsmålet mitt var, ja, han en adventist?
And she said, no, but he's very nice to me.
Nei, sa hun, men han veldig snill mot meg.
Ladies, I want to be very plain here tonight with you.
Og kvinner, jeg ønsker å være veldig tydelig med dere her I kveld.
And this is a very worldly saying, but I want you to understand. I know you'll understand this.
Det er kanskje en verslig uttalelse, men jeg tror dere forstår det.
He might be a 10.
Han he might be a 10?
10, yeah. Like they'll understand that. I know they understand this.
Jeg forstår det ikke.
But if he's not SDA.
Men hvis han Ja, jeg ikke fra den verden. Men hvis han ikke en adventist,
it's a zero. Do you get that?
Så det et null.
It's not even like a 5 or a 6. If he's not SDA, it's an automatic zero. Do you get that?
Hvis han ikke adventist, så han automatisk et null.
Because this was her argument. This was her reasoning.
For dette var hennes argument, og dette var hennes måte å resonere på.
Our town is so small.
Ja, men landsbyen vår så liten.
There's no Adventist guys for me here.
Det jo ikke noen adventist-typer for meg her.
Have any of you ever played this song before?
Det noen av dere som har spilt denne sangen før?
I know that someone in here is thinking the same thing right now.
Jeg vet at noen her inne tenker den samme tingen akkurat nå.
Norway only has like 5,000 Adventists.
Norge har bare 5,000 adventister.
Maybe 2,000 young people.
Kanskje 2,000 unge.
I don't know, but you get the idea,
ikke.
Right?
Men dere får ideen, ikke sant?
And you know what? I've been to these conferences and I know there's not a lot of people.
Og jeg har reist til disse konferansene, jeg vet at det ikke så veldig godt utvalg.
And so the first temptation that Satan brings.
Så den første fristelsen som Satan kommer med
is to unite yourself with someone who is not equally yoked.
Det å forene seg med en der hvor man ikke, altså der hvor man går I åk med en vantro.
I want to challenge you right now because if you can see what happens to Lot.
Jeg vil utfordre dere, for hvis dere ser hva som skjedde med Lot.
See, Not only was she selfish and irreligious.
Det var ikke bare det at hans kone var selvisk og ikke religiøs inklinert.
I want to read something. It says the influence of his wife. Oh no, sorry. I'm sorry. It says, but for her, Lot would not have remained in Sodom, deprived of the counsel of the God-fearing patriarch.
Hvis det ikke hadde vært for kona, så hadde ikke Lot flyttet til Sodoma.
It says her influence was exerted to separate her husband from Abraham.
Hennes innflytelse skilte Lot ifra Abraham. Lot hadde ellers hørt på Abraham.
This woman was trying as much as she could to keep Lot in a place where he would not be able to hear God's voice.
Denne kvinnen forsøkte å få Lot et sted der han ikke kunne lytte til Guds stemme.
And do you see that what Lot lost was really the result of the choices that he had made years ago?
Og det som Lot mistet, det var et resultat av de valgene som han hadde tatt for mange år siden.
See, Lot lost everything in one night.
Lot mistet alt I løpet av en natt.
But the chains had been forged slowly many, many years ago.
Men disse lenkene, de hadde blitt formet sakte men sikkert for mange år siden.
And you know, I have a true story. This is a true story. And I had another church.
Og jeg har en annen sann historie fra en annen menighet som jeg var pastor I.
We had a young lady in there. She was a nurse.
Vi hadde en ung kvinne I denne menigheten. Hun var sykepleier.
She dated a few of the members of the church. It didn't work out.
Hun hadde et forhold med noen av de andre menighetsmedlemmene, men det fungerte ikke.
And one day she brought to church this very tall, handsome young man.
Og så en dag så kom hun til menigheten med denne flotte fyren, høy og flott, fin, vakker.
He was a pilot.
Han var pilot.
He flew his own planes.
Han flydde fly.
His job, he fixed, you know, oil, like oil drills. He had a company that fixed those oil wells.
Och han hade sin egen bedrift som ordnat slike oljehull.
And for vacation he would fly to the Bahamas and go fishing.
Och I ferierna sina så flög han till Bahamas för att fiska.
And let me tell you, even some of our church members were saying, oh, "You're so lucky."
Och jag kan säga det att det själv någon av menighetsmedlemmarna sa, "Wow, du är heldig."
And see, this is the problem. We are so conditioned by society to just look at, oh, they have this job, they have this, you know, these skills, and they look like this. But God says, if you're unequally yoked, it is not His will.
Og der ser det, vi så påvirket av samfunnet rundt oss, og vi tenker, ok, wow, hvis han har den jobben og ser sånn ut. Men Bibelen sier at vi skal ikke gå I fremmed åk med vantro.
I want to challenge you because I believe that there are some of you in here that this part of the message is very applicable to.
Jeg vil utfordre dere, for jeg tror at det noen her inne som dette budskapet kommer til å tale til.
Someday,
en dag,
the final events will come and they will come rapidly.
Så kommer de siste begivenhetene og de vil skje I hast.
And when they come,
og når de kommer,
where you will be on that day will depend on the decisions that you are making right now.
Hvor du vil være på den dagen, det avhenger av de beslutningene som du tar I dag.
Come with me back to Luke 17.
Bli med meg tilbake til Lukas kapittel 17.
Verse 30 says this.
I vers 30 så står det.
Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed.
Slik skal det også være den dagen menneskesønnen blir åpenbart.
I want to ask you a question.
Jeg vil stille dere et spørsmål.
And don't overthink this.
Og dere får ikke tenke for grundig over det.
What does it mean in verse 30 when it says in the day that the Son of Man is revealed? What event is that?
Hvilken begivenhet det snakk om her I vers 30? Slik skal det også være den dagen menneskesønnen blir åpenbart. Hvilken begivenhet?
It's the second coming, right? Everybody
Yes.
can see that, right?
Jesu ankomme, ikke sant? Det ikke vanskelig å se.
Okay, now let's read verse 31.
Og så la oss lese da vers 31.
In that day,
på den dagen,
what day?
Hvilken dag?
At the second coming, right?
Jesu ankomme.
In that day, he which shall be upon the housetop and his stuff in the house, let him not come down to take it away, and he that is in the field, let him likewise not return back.
På den dagen må ikke den som på hustaket og har eiendelene sine I huset komme ned for å hente dem. Slik også med den som ute på marken, han må ikke vende tilbake.
I want to ask you a question.
Jeg vil stille deg et spørsmål.
Can anyone tell me when Jesus comes back a second time?
Kan någon fortælle mig när Jesus kommer igen för en gång?
What's going to happen to the sky?
Vad är det som ska ske uppe på himlen?
What's going to happen?
Vad är det som ska ske?
Good. It's going to get rolled back like a scroll, right?
Ja,
okay, good.
Himlen ska rullas tillbaka som en bokrull.
What's going to happen to planet Earth?
Vad är det som ska ske med planeten Jorden?
Earthquakes.
Ja, jordskjelv.
Do they have earthquakes here in Norway?
Har vi jordskjelv her I Norge?
No, no. So I have been in two earthquakes.
Men jeg har vært I to jordskjelv.
Just like number five. like five
ja,
on a Richter scale.
Fem på Richter skala.
Let me tell you, if you are ever in an earthquake, it doesn't matter what religion or what faith, you will believe in God, okay? Because the earthquake makes you see how human power is nothing.
Når du I et jordskjelv, så det bare som at du tvinges til å tro på Gud, for du ser liksom at alt rystes.
Now, what else happens when Jesus comes?
Hva det ellers som skjer når Jesus kommer igjen?
It says every mountain and island will be moved, right? Some islands will just disappear, right?
Det står at hvert fjell og hver øy skal flyttes. Noen øyer kommer til å forsvinne.
I want you to imagine you are alive when Jesus comes.
Og jeg vil at du skal forestille deg at du levende når Jesus kommer igjen.
The sky, the atmosphere is just peeled back.
Og du ser bare hvordan atmosfæren krøller seg sammen som en bokrull.
There is upheavals and the earthquakes, buildings are falling down.
Jordskjelv, bygninger faller ned.
How many of you will be thinking about your car?
Hvor mange av dere det da som begynner å tenke på, åh, bilen min?
How many of you be thinking about your flat screen TV?
Hvor mange det som da tenker på flatskjermen, TV-skjermen?
How many of you would be thinking about your house?
Hvor mange det som tenker på huset sitt?
I know some of you are laughing like that would be stupid.
Og noen av dere ler, for det vil jo være dumt.
I mean, Jesus is coming.
Jesus kommer igjen.
The end is here.
Nå enden kommet.
I wouldn't care about those things.
Åh, da hadde jeg ikke brydd meg om disse materialistiske tingene I det hele tatt.
Then Jesus says in the next verse.
Og så sier Jesus I det neste verset.
What?
Hva?
Remember Lot's wife.
Husk Lots kone.
Oh, I get it.
Ah.
Lot's wife did the same thing.
Jeg forstår, Lots kone, hun gjorde det samme.
God said everything is going to be destroyed, like everything is going to be destroyed.
Gud sa alt ska ødelegges, absolutt alt.
And in that time she was only her only job was get out.
Og den eneste oppgaven hennes var å komme seg ut av byen.
But do you know what she was thinking about?
Men vet dere hva hun tenkte på?
Look at verse 30.
Se på vers 30.
I'm sorry, look at verse 31.
31.
She was thinking about her stuff.
Hun tenkte på alle eiendelene sine.
Now I want to say something.
Og jeg har lyst til å si noe.
Some of you in here have homes.
Noen av dere her inne har hjem.
And you're paying them off. Do they do mortgages in Norway? I know this is a dumb question, but I know this is a rich country. So.
Det sånn at man, yeah, they do, right? Man nedbetaler et hjem? Okay. So, har man opp gjeld her I Norge også? Ja, det gjør vi selvfølgelig.
Imagine you have like a 15-year mortgage.
Så la oss si at du har et lån som går over 15 år.
And look, there's nothing wrong with having a house, right? Amen?
Og det ikke noe galt med å ha et hus, ikke sant?
Let's just say.
La oss bare si.
That you paid off 14 years of 15-year mortgage.
At du hadde nedbetalt 14 år ut av 15 år.
So, in other words, the house is almost yours.
Så med andre ord, huset nesten ditt.
And then let's say.
Og så la oss si.
That Jesus comes.
At Jesus kommer igjen.
Do you think that you could be tempted with the possibility that wow, I worked like for 14 years to pay, and now it's all gone to waste.
Tror du du kunne bli fristet til å tenke, nå har jeg betalt ned på dette huset I 14 år, og nå det alt for intet?
Now I'm going to do something, and I want you to follow this carefully.
Og jeg skal gjøre noe nå, jeg vil at dere følger nøye med.
You know that the Gospels, they have the same passages, right? The three, you know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke.
Dere vet at evangeliene, Matteus, Markus og Lukas, har liksom lignende avsnitt.
Go back to Matthew.
Så gå med meg tilbake til Matteus evangeliet.
And look at Matthew 24.
Og se på Matteus kapittel 24.
I want you to look at verse 15.
Jeg vil at dere skal se på vers 15.
The Bible says.
Bibelen sier.
When you shall see the abomination of desolation standing spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand.
Når du da ser ødeleggelsens avskyelighet som profeten Daniel talte om, stå på det hellige sted, den som leser ham forstå det.
Now I want to ask you a question.
Jeg vil stille deg et spørsmål.
Does anybody know what event is the equivalent of the abomination of desolation in AD 70 in our time? Does anybody know what is the equivalent of that event in our time?
Vet du vilken begivenhet som tilsvarende til denne ødeleggelsens styggedom som ble skrevet om her som skjedde I år 70? Hva det som tilsvarende I vår tid?
It's the National Sunday Law.
Det den nasjonale søndagsloven.
Okay, so do you understand this? When the National Sunday Law comes,
så når den nasjonale søndagsloven kommer,
Jesus has some instructions for his disciples.
Så har Jesus noen instruksjon til sine disipler.
Verse 16.
Vers 16.
Then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains.
Da må de som I Judea flykte opp I fjellene.
Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house.
Og den som på hustaket må ikke gå ned for å hente noe ut fra huset.
Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes.
Den som ute på marken må ikke gå tilbake for å hente klærne sine.
Wait, didn't we just read that?
Leste vi ikke nettopp om det?
Where did we read that?
Hvor leste vi det?
That was in Luke.
Det var I Lukas, ikke sant?
I don't know if you realize this, but right when the Sunday law is announced, and I know you guys had a seminar with which I listened to by Norman on the four stages of the Sunday law.
Når søndagsloven blir annonsert, kan man si, og jeg vet at dere hadde seminar med Norman om de fire stegene I søndagsloven.
When the Sunday law comes, Ellen White tells us that at that time it will be time for us to leave the larger cities to find retired places in the country to live.
Så skriver Ellen White om at når dette inntreffer, så det at Guds folk skal se det som et tegn til at de skal forlate byen og finne seg steder ute på landet.
I believe that there will be people that will not do it because they finished paying off their 15-year mortgage.
Og jeg tror det vil være mennesker som ikke vil gjøre det på grunn av at de nettopp har nedbetalt lånene sine.
And I know what some of you are saying. You're saying, no way, if it's me, I know that when the Sunday law comes, I'm going to walk away, no problem.
Og jeg vet at flere av dere sitter her og tenker at ja, nei, hadde det vært meg, så det helt klart jeg skulle forlatt dette huset jeg har nedbetalt. Ikke noe problem.
So I want to tell you something about myself.
Men jeg vil fortelle dere noe om meg selv.
In my life, I own three Land Cruisers.
I løpet av livet mitt, så har jeg eid tre Land Cruisere.
I still own one. I gave it to my son.
Og jeg fremdeles en som jeg gitt til sønnen min.
It's my favorite car.
Det min favorittbil.
And I want to tell you that in my experience from my short little life.
Og jeg vil fortelle at I min erfaring fra mitt korte liv.
I finished paying one off.
Så klarte jeg nedbetale en.
Then my ex-wife got it.
Og så fikk ekskona mi den bilen.
It was so difficult to let it go.
Og det var så vanskelig å la den gå.
So I bought another one.
Så jeg kjøpte en annen.
And my second wife made me sell it.
Og så fikk den andre kona mi meg til å selge den.
I don't know if you know, but Land Cruisers, like, they get terrible gas mileage, like the worst gas mileage.
Altså sånne, de ikke så veldig snille på mila da, med bensin, de tar mye bensin.
So then I got the third one.
Så fikk jeg den tredje.
And my wife said, you have to get rid of it or you have to give it to someone.
Og så sa kona mi, nei, den må du kvitte deg med, eller så får du får gi den bort.
Now, this is not the same as a house.
Og det selvfølgelig ikke det samme som et hus.
But it shows the human nature's attachment to material things that you love.
Men det viser hvordan menneskenaturen lett for å hekte seg på ting som man elsker, materielle ting I denne verden.
I don't know what your Land Cruiser is. It could be a house, it could be a boat, it could be a purse, it could be anything.
Og jeg vet ikke hva deres Land Cruiser om det et hus eller en veske eller hva det måtte være.
But the point is that there will be people that will be lost at the end of time simply because they cannot walk away from things that they have spent their lifetime building or accumulating.
Men saken at mange mennesker vil gå fortapt fordi de ikke villige til å forlate de tingene som de har investert I og som de har bygd opp.
Now there's something that you may not know.
Det noe som dere kanskje ikke vet.
Lot's wife was not only motivated by the possessions that she left behind.
Lots kone var ikke bare motivert av de eiendelene som hun hadde etterlatt seg.
There's one more thing that she was struggling with. Does anybody know what
it was? Det var en ting til som hun slet med. Vet dere hva det var?
Her children.
Barna.
She had at least two daughters still in the city.
Hun hadde I det minste to barn som var igjen I den byen.
I want you now. I know that not all of you are parents, but some of you are parents here.
Og jeg vet at ikke alle dere her har rukket å bli foreldre, men det noen foreldre her.
I want you to imagine Sunday law is announced.
Og jeg vil at dere skal forestille dere at søndagslovene her.
And so you tell your family, okay, guys, this is the signal. It's time for us to leave this place, to leave the big city. We have got to go to the country.
Og så sier du til familien din, dette signalet. Nå det på tide at vi flytter ut på landet.
I want you to imagine that your 16-year-old teenager says to you.
Og så vil jeg at du skal forestille deg at din 16-åring, din tenåring sier til deg.
Dad, I googled it and I think that this is a conspiracy theory. Like I don't think this is true.
Nei, pappa, dette har jeg googlet, og dette bare en konspirasjonsteori det her som du tror på.
What if they said something like, Dad, you know what? If you don't mind, I'll just stay, but you can go.
Tenk om vedkommende sa, ja, men pappa, jeg blir her. Du får reise hvis du vil.
I'm not trying to be funny. I'm very serious right now.
Og det ikke det at jeg prøver å være morsom nå, så jeg faktisk helt alvorlig. Mener det helt alvorlig.
I believe that there are some parents that will reason, you know what? I'm going to stay to save my child.
Jeg tror at flere foreldre kommer til å resonere på denne måten, at jeg kommer til å bli for å redde barna.
Do you know that there's nothing wrong with owning a house?
Vet du at det ikke noe feil med å eie et hus?
Unless it keeps you from obeying what God says.
Hvis ikke det holder deg tilbake fra å adlyde det som Gud sier.
There's nothing wrong with loving your children.
Det ikke noe galt med å elske barna dine.
Unless it keeps you from obeying what God says.
Hvis ikke det holder deg tilbake fra å adlyde det som Gud sier.
I know some of you are saying right now, you're saying, I am not that kind of parent.
Og så det kanskje noen der som sier at ja, men jeg ikke den type forelder.
You know how you know if you're that kind of a parent or not?
Vet dere hvordan dere kan vite om dere en sånn type foreldre eller ikke?
I'm going to tell you a true story. This happened at my church.
Jeg skal fortelle dere en sann historie til som skjedde I en av menighetene jeg var pastor for.
I had a couple that came and they said, "We love this church. It's so amazing."
Det var et par der og de sa det at vi elsker denne menigheten. Det sånn en fantastisk menighet.
And we invited them. We said, "Look, we'll be here next Sabbath. Please join us."
Og vi sa, "Kom igjen da. Bli med oss. Vi her fremdeles neste sabbat."
They said, "Ah, I'm so sad to hear that because on Saturday we have basketball practice for our kids."
Åh, det var jo kjedelig, sa de, for akkurat på lørdager så har vi basketballtrening med barna.
You know, it sounds strange, but parents feel like they have to give their kids the best opportunities, even if it breaks the Sabbath.
Og det høres rart ut, men foreldre tror at de må gi barna sine de beste anledninger, om det så betyr at de må bryte Guds bud, bryte sabbaten.
If you would be willing to break the Sabbath in order that your kids can have an advantage,
hvis du villig til å bryte sabbaten for at barna dine skal kunne ha en fordel,
then you would be willing to disobey God in order to be with your kids.
Så du villig til å være ulydig mot Gud for å følge barna.
You see, friends, right now we are either being freed or forging the chains that will bind us to this earth or to take us to heaven.
Akkurat nå så det enten sånn at vi frigjør oss eller at vi former disse lenkene som vi holder seg I jorda. I stedet for at vi kommer opp til himmelen.
I believe very strongly that some of you, by God's help, will avoid the pitfall of Satan, and you will find someone who is a believer like yourself, marrying within the faith.
Og jeg tror at dere vil unngå Satans snarer, og at dere vil finne dere en ektefelle som har samme troen som dere.
But if Satan doesn't get you by that,
men hvis ikke Satan får deg på det punktet,
he has the next trap laid, which is called materialism.
Så har han en annen snare, og den kalles materialisme.
You do not have to be wealthy to be materialistic.
Du behøver ikke være rik for å være en materialist.
I have been materialistic and I am poor.
Jeg har vært en materialist, og jeg fattig.
The idea is simply that you love things more than people or more than God.
Ideen at du elsker ting mer enn du elsker mennesker eller Gud.
You know why I say more than people? When my kids spilled juice in my Land Cruiser, I went crazy, like, this is my car, don't do that.
Og det jeg sier at du elsker ting mer enn mennesker. Altså hvis barna mine sølte juice I den Land Cruiseren, så ble jeg jo så sinnet.
But if you think about it, kids is way more important than a car. Does that make sense?
Men når man tenker på det, så jo barna mye viktigere enn en bil.
And so right now, Satan is really, you know, this is a term, but he has the hooks in us. Because as a society, we are being conditioned to be more and more and more materialistic.
Og det som at Satan har oss på kroken, for som en menneskehet, så blir vi mer og mer materialistiske.
I'm going to take a little side detour at this point in the sermon.
Og nå vil jeg ta bare en liten sidevei I talen.
You know that Sodom and Gomorrah was a very wicked city. You know that, right?
Dere vet at Sodoma og Gomorra var veldig onde byer, ikke sant?
And I actually read something very interesting because she says that Sodom and Gomorrah was the most, and this is the quote, the most beautiful country.
Og jeg leste veldig interessant. Faktisk Sodoma og Gomorra, eller jeg skriver at det var det vakreste landet.
I have been to some of the most rough countries in the world.
Jeg har vært I noen av de mest, rough, altså noen av de områdene I verden som minst vakre.
I was in Haiti.
Jeg var I Haiti.
We saw dead bodies swollen because nobody had collected them on the road.
Vi så døde mennesker som lå der på gata, og de var helt svellet opp fordi ingen hadde samlet dem opp.
This past June, I was in the Democratic Republic of Congo.
Og nå sist I juni så var jeg I Kongo.
That is a rough country.
Det et hardt sted.
But if you asked me, where would be the modern equivalent of Sodom and Gomorrah?
Men hvis dere hadde stilt meg spørsmålet, hvor det vi kan se en moderne sammenligning til Sodom og Gomorra?
It wouldn't be in these like, you know, armpit of the world places. It would not be in that.
Så hadde det ikke vært de type stedene som jeg nevnte her, som så harde og grusomme og lite tiltalende.
Sodom and Gomorrah were rich.
For Sodom og Gomorra var rike.
They had so much money that they had plenty of time to have ease. They loved ease.
De hadde så mye penger, de hadde så mye overflod at de også hadde masse fritid.
And you know, when you don't have to work so hard,
og når du ikke må jobbe så hardt,
that breeds evil.
Så det med å føde fram ondskap.
In addition to this, you know, wealth that they had, it was a beautiful area.
Og I tillegg til at det var veldig rike byer, så var det et vakkert område.
They were proud of their country.
De var stolte av landet sitt.
It's okay to be proud of your country.
Og det greit å være stolt av landet sitt.
But when you get too proud, you start developing something called prejudice.
Men når man begynner å bli for stolt,
and you look down on everybody else.
Så begynner man å få fordommer, og så begynner man å se ned på andre.
I have to tell you that if you were to look for the modern day Sodom and Gomorrah.
Og jeg tror jeg kan si det at hvis dere ser etter en moderne Sodom og Gomorra.
Look for a wealthy country.
Så se på et rikt land.
That's beautiful.
Vakkert land.
Its inhabitants have plenty of opportunity to have free time.
Der hvor innbyggerne har mye fritid, muligheter for fritid.
But I know some of you are thinking I'm implying that Norway is Sodom. I'm not. You guys are looking at me like, what's he saying?
Og så begynner dere å kverne og tenke at jeg nå snakker om Norge, som det moderne Sodom og Gomorra.
Okay, but I have to say this.
Men jeg må si dette likevel.
Stig Larsson was Swedish.
Stig Larsson var svensk.
Am I right?
Det sant?
Some of you don't know what I'm saying, but some of you do.
Det noen av dere som vet hva jeg sier.
My point is, you develop some of the weirdest evil ideas and concepts when you have the perfect like mix of all of these things, wealth and ease and luxury and beauty.
Ja, når man har en kombinasjon av alle disse elementene, mye fritid, overflod, rikdom, skjønnhet, så kan det faktisk være med å skape de verste tanker og ideer.
Okay, if Satan doesn't get you on the materialism.
Og hvis Satan ikke får hektet deg gjennom materialismen,
he has the final trap set.
Så har han en annen snare.
I'm a parent.
Jeg en far.
I love my children.
Og jeg elsker barna mine.
And I can tell you that there were times when I idolized them in the sense that I put them above God.
Och jag kan säga, jag kan inrömma att det var tider I livet mitt där jag idoliserade mina barn, satte dem över Gud.
I allowed them to do things that I knew probably weren't good.
Och jag tillät dem att göra ting som jag egentligen visste inte var bra.
But I want to challenge you if you're a parent here tonight.
Men jag vill utmana er hvis dere foreldre her I kveld.
There are things coming ahead of us that will test every soul to its very core.
Det ting som kommer oss I møte som vil sette enhver sjel på prøve.
And you know, as I look at this group and like man, you guys are wonderful parents and I see how, you know, loving and kind. I see all of that.
Og når jeg ser på denne gruppen så ser jeg jo at det fantastisk kjærlige, flotte foreldre her.
But remember that Satan will or try to capitalize on that affection in a way that will estrange or alienate you from what God is calling you to do.
Men vær klar over at Satan kan bruke selv det, din kjærlighet overfor dine barn, til å fjerne og gjøre deg fremmed overfor Guds krav.
As we close this message this evening.
I det vi avslutter dette budskapet.
I want to invite everyone in here to just bow your heads and close your eyes for a moment.
Så vil jeg invitere alle til å bøye hodet, lukke øynene.
As we prepare to pray,
I det vi forbereder oss på å be.
Maybe someone in here tonight is saying, Lord, I have this relationship and I know that they are not SDA.
Och det kan hända att det är någon här som vet att de har ett förhåll med en som inte är adventist.
But I love him slash her.
Men jag älskar ham eller henne.
And I don't know what to do because I love them and I don't want to give them up.
Och jag vet verkligen inte vad jag ska göra för jag älskar den personen och jag vill inte ge den upp.
My mind knows what's right but my heart does not follow.
Sinnet mitt vet vad som är rätt men känslorna följer inte.
Be honest with God tonight.
Var ärlig med Gud ikväll.
If you can be honest and say Lord I love them but I you know I want to do what's right.
Hvis du kan være ærlig med Gud I kveld og si at ja, jeg elsker dem, men jeg ønsker å gjøre det som rett.
Would you just raise your hand and say, Lord, please give me the strength to do what is right?
Vil du rekke opp hånda og si, Herre, gi meg styrke til å gjøre det som rett?
Before we pray, maybe there are some in here tonight that recognize that materialism has taken root and hold in their life.
Og før vi ber, så videre så tenker jeg også at det kanskje noen her som kjenner at materialismen har tatt grep om dem I livet.
Maybe there are parents in here that are needing special prayer for their children that they would be converted and follow the Lord wholly.
Och kanske är det föräldrar här som trenger speciell förbön för barna sina att de verkligen ska bli omvänt och helgjort.
Won't you just raise your hand and say Lord please intercede on the behalf of my children. You love them more than I love them.
Och då har du möjlighet att räcka handen I vädret och säga det att Herre jag vill att du ska gå I förbön. Du älskar dem högre än jag älskar dem.
Let's pray Father in heaven.
La oss be, far I himmelen.
You see every soul laid bare before you tonight.
Du ser hver sjel som blottlagt framfor deg I kveld.
Lord, you can see each of our hearts and you understand our specific struggles.
Du kjenner hjertene våre og våre spesifikke kamper.
It's my prayer that for everyone that is sincerely seeking help in their struggle with what is to come.
Det min oppriktige bønn at for hver og en som søker hjelp og for de kampene som ligger framfor dem,
you would pour out your divine grace.
Så skal du øse ut din guddommelige nåde.
Lord, you have brought us this far.
Du har brakt oss så langt.
Help us to trust you to take this ship safely to harbor.
Hjelp oss å stole på deg at du vil bringe dette skipet trygt I havn.
Be our captain and our guide.
Vær vår kaptein, vær vår veileder.
In Jesus' name we pray.
I Jesu navn.
Amen.
Amen.
come to the end of our program for tonight. So happy Sabbath, continuation, and we'll see you back here tomorrow.